Hello, pen friends. Welcome to The Pen Habit and another fun review video. Now, this pen's going to be a little bit tricky to talk about. Not because there's anything wrong with the pen or anything like that. It's just that it's kind of hard to explain, and I'm not even sure I have all the information right. I've done a lot of research, and I've talked with a bunch of people about it, but it's hard to track down these pens. And the pen in question today is the Parker Duofold Mark II Centennial Lapis Lazuli. There's a lot of qualifiers on this. So obviously, if you've been around the pen community at all, Parker is probably one of those names that you know. Parker was responsible for some of the most significant advances in early fountain pen hood. They've been around for a long time. They are responsible for creating the original Duofold, which is one of the most popular pens of the 20s and the 30s. They created the Vacuumatic, which was kind of mind-blowing materials at the time. A variety of nibs that to this day are still spectacular writers. Very highly sought after by collectors. Now, obviously, the Parker Company has changed a lot since the early heyday of its life as a fountain pen company. But they moved I'm referring to my notes here to make sure I don't screw up too much. So they moved their headquarters from Janesville, Wisconsin to England in 1987. The company was purchased in 1993 by Gillette, which sold it to Rubbermaid Newell in 2000. And then in 2009, Parker closed its U.S. and British plants and moved its production to France, and unfortunately, in many cases, to China. And so as a result, modern Parker fountain pens have kind of fallen out of top of mind with fountain pen people. They don't, like many of the legacy brands, and I'm thinking of Waterman and Schaefer, the modern iteration of Parker, which has now been bought and sold and conglomerated and grouped with a company making, you know, Rubbermaid products, they don't innovate and iterate the way they used to back in the old days. They have their models don't change a lot. And this is one of those kind of. So back in, you know, the company moved the headquarters to England in 1987, but it was still Parker Pen Company. It was still owned by Parker. And then in the late 80s, they came out with the Parker Duofold Mark II, of which this pen is one. This is one of the early ones, and this is the lapis lazuli material. It is an acrylic, beautiful, rich blue, lots of swirls of lighter blue and darker blue in there. I was talking with Andy Lambrew at, I think it was a San Francisco show in 2016, and he mentioned that this acrylic it's not a poured acrylic, it's a pressed acrylic. So they press it down to make it solid. And he said sometimes that can cause problems with the acrylic being not super stable. I've not done a lot of research into it. I haven't had any problems with this particular pen, but nor have I heard of a lot of problems. But Andy knows his stuff, so I am inclined to listen to and believe him when he says stuff like that. It harkens back to the early Duofolds, and I did a review of a 1940s era Duofold, which I'll link to in the show notes / written review, and the cards at the end of this video. But they've followed that original design pretty closely, but modernized it a little bit in the late 80s. So at the top, you've got this Duofold button, which is not going to focus on me here, I don't think, unless I try that. There we go. So it's a beautiful design, really, really nicely etched into the finial there. And then I'll refocus down here. You've got the black kind of conical finial here, a gold-plated arrow clip, and a double, very wide cap band down here. And then the barrel barrel expands a little bit and then tapers down. You've got another gold ring and a black finial on the end here. Unlike a lot of the earlier Parker pens, this one does not have an imprint inside of the barrel, but it does have a little bit of a marking down here that says made in UK. So this was one of the UK made pens. And then you've got the Parker logo right there. It's a very pretty pen. It's one that doesn't get a ton of attention, but that the people who like these pens are really into them. There was a gentleman named Gerald who used to run a site called My Coffee Pot. He ended up ceasing a blog called My Coffee Pot. He ended up ceasing that blog because he got busy with other things, but he was an absolute fanatic for these. And they come in a ton of different materials and different colors of different eras. You know, a lot of them were not in production for a long time, and so some of them can be very hard to find. Nor were they particularly inexpensive pens. These were pretty expensive pens, especially for the time. So let's go ahead and do a comparison of... Oh, before I do that, let's maybe show you what's under the cap here. So you've got a nice black section here with a little bit of a curvature to it, and then a little flange, and then this beautiful bicolor nib. With, it says Parker 18K750, and you got the Parker logo across the top with the neat design in it. Now, these came in two sizes, the Centennial and the Heritage size. So the Centennial is the larger version, and then the Heritage is the smaller version. So now, all of that information I gave you is what I believe to be correct. I'm sure I've gotten some of it wrong, and there's some serious Parker files out there who are going to be able to correct any misinformation that I gave. So make sure to check in the comments for those really popular or those really knowledgeable Parker folks who can correct me on some of the information that I give. This is what I was able to find from my research, but there's a lot of information about Parker out there and it can be really tricky to track down. Okay, so now let's do some measurements and some comparisons, and then I'm gonna show you how this lovely 18 karat nib writes. Thank you. before we dive into the writing review, a couple of quick notes. One, you probably heard Luke the dog barking during the writing sample. I actually have the back door open while I'm recording this, and he's laying out in the backyard. He almost never barks, except for when someone is walking by the house with the dog, and then he insists on singing the song of his people. The other thing I want to mention is the ink I used as part of this review is Montblanc Honoré de Balzac Dandy Turquoise. It's my favorite turquoise ink in existence. It is also a special edition from 2013, 2014, somewhere right around there, that is no longer available from Montblanc. And even if it were, they would have doubled the price because that's apparently what they're doing on their special edition inks. So this year in 2018 is you may see the empty bottle 2018 challenge that's been going around the community, or 2018 empty bottle. I forget the exact hashtag. Head over to penhabit.com. I'll link to it there. But the goal is to like empty a bottle of ink this year, at least one. And so because this is one of my favorite inks and I only have a couple of bottles of it, I have been not using it because I wanted to save it. But I realized I don't even realize what I want to save it for. Like, I would hate to not use it and then have it go bad on me or lose its color or whatever. I'm like, why am I not using this? The fact that it's a limited resource doesn't mean it shouldn't be used. So this is the color that I am hoping to accomplish the empty bottle 2018 challenge with. There's another couple too that I'm looking at, but this is the main one, because I've got about a half of a bottle left of this one, and then I've got a bottle and a half left, but I want to empty out that half bottle at the very least. So anyway, let's now go into the writing review. So this is an interesting writing experience. It's not bad, but I don't love it either. The nib tip is weird. Sometimes it feels super smooth and wet and juicy, and other times it just doesn't. And it's particularly sensitive to the angle at which the pen is held. So if I roll it this way, for instance, it feels scratchy. If I roll it this way, it's like without rolled, it's actually quite nice. And you can see it's actually even a little bit stub-like. It's a little bit wider on the downstrokes than the cross strokes. Now, this is the medium gauge. So that, you know, it tends to be a little bit on the stubby side of medium, but it's not like it's smooth, but sometimes it's not. And you probably heard in the review when I first started writing, it was squeaking or singing a little bit in a not very pleasant way. So sometimes it's great. Other times it's not. And I haven't been able to pin down exactly why that is. Perhaps it's the ink. I think it tends to be very sensitive to being unused for a long period of time. So I tend to have more problems when I haven't used it for a while. If I use it regularly and use it every day, I don't seem to have as many problems. I've also seen just a tiny bit of ink starvation. It's not huge, but it's enough to be mildly annoying at times. There's a little bit of bounce to the nib here. I'll do the reverse writing. It's moderately scratchy, but usable if you needed to do a very fine line here. Pretty dry. In terms of wetness, it's moderate, but slightly on the dry side of moderate. It's not the wettest pen in the world. I think I'm going to take this to a Nibmeister and have him or her just adjust the ink flow a little bit. I could probably do it myself, but you know, if I get a chance to take it to Mr. Masayama, I would really like to do that because I love his work. And I might just send it to him rather than take it to him at a pen show because I trust him. But I like the writing experience. I don't love it. In the hand, I love it. This is an extremely comfortable pen. It can be posted, but it doesn't post deeply, and it gets very long and kind of back heavy. It's also a really nice moderate weight. So uncapped, it's 20 grams, which I find to be it still feels light, but you get just that little extra heft of weight that gives you, you know, kind of moves the pen along through the paper. So I got this pen largely because I was really fascinated at the glowing reviews that Gerald gave the pen. I like it a lot. I think it's a beautiful pen. I love the kind of vintage vibe it has, but it is a modern pen. I need to get the nib worked on, and then I think this is a pen I will turn to a lot. The threads are ludicrously smooth, which I really like. One other thing I forgot to mention a little bit earlier on was that this does use Parker proprietary converters. So you can't use a standard international here. It does need the Parker converters. If you have an Aurora pen, Aurora uses Parker style converters as well. So those are kind of interchangeable between them. So you could use Aurora ink cartridges in here or Parker ink cartridges if you can find them. They're not easy to find. Or a converter to use bottled ink. You can't use this as an eyedropper though, because the section is made of metal. So the tenon on the section will be in contact, direct contact with the ink. All right. So that is my writing review of the Parker Duofold Mark II Lapis Lazuli. So when these pens came out in the late 1980s, they were not cheap. They sold for $500. Now, I have seen a lot of these Parker Duofolds from the late 80s, early 90s era floating around at pen shows. There's still a lot of them out there, and they're pretty easy to find. I also don't see a lot of them going for a ton of money. Now, there are some variations out there, certain nib designs that are very popular, or materials that are very uncommon, or combinations thereof that will cause the value to the secondary market value to go up. I paid $350 for this. So these, if you were holding on to these from, you know, from 20 years ago, hoping that you were going to get a huge, or 30 years ago, hoping you were going to get a huge return on investment, I just don't think it came to bear with these pens. These just did not capture the imagination of the fountain pen community the way other pens have. They're still wonderful pens. I find them beautiful. There's a green marble one out there that I really like that I would love to get a hold of. There's some with like a checkered design on them. There's some that have like an ace design on the nib that are very pretty. So there's a lot of them out there. They're fairly affordable. And if you can get one with a really good nib on it, I think you'd be happy with this pen. They're nicely made. The nib on this is just weird enough for the way I write that I need to have a little bit of work done on it. But once I do, I think I'm going to like the pen quite a bit and do consider it to be a pretty darn good value. So that should do it for my review of the Parker Duofold Mark II Lapis Lazuli from the late 1980s. If you have questions or comments or your own experience with this reboot of the Parker Duofolds, did I say vacuumatic earlier? If I did, I meant Duofold. Then I'd love to hear what your experience has been. So leave that in the comments section below. If you liked the video, please give it a thumbs up. If you hated the video, please give it 2 thumbs downs. And we will see you here soon on another review video here on the Pen Habit. So thanks for watching. Take care. Bye.